Well, I think some of it has to do with religious context. I think a lot of it comes from, I mean, very few people know that the Catholic Church did in fact marry same-sex people in the Middle Ages, but for money. And later on, it was in fact true that they ceased to do those kinds of behaviors and they began to change. I think that there are a number of different waves of change that happen in the European context. The work of Michel Foucault has spent years talking, he spent years studying and talking about how Greek and Roman ideology became transformed in the context of what is today Europe to create a kind of aesthetic discipline that disavowed homosexuality as a part of it. And eventually, he says that it shifts from an ars erotica, or an erotic art form, or a kind of romantic conversation about eroticism, to a scientia sexualis, is his particular statement. And what he means is that we begin to taxonomically reduce it to a disease. And this happens somewhere around the 1800s, 1860s, but it's conversely true that at that time is when the European sexology movement begins to develop, as does psychology and a number of other fields. So, but I wouldn't exactly tie that to the place where Western culture went against homosexuality. I think that there are many examples, including George Chauncey's work, which show with no doubt whatsoever that in, for instance, New York City in the 1930s, there were thriving homosexual communities that were doing very well. And there's some indication that, in fact, early American society had homosexuality in many, many places, even with religious strictures being what they were. So I think it's again, dependent upon the context of the society that houses it, because homosexuality is a social construct. And the society itself influences to a great deal how it is perceived, how it's treated, how it's warred against or accepted and brought into being a part of everyday life.